This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Mosaic, a daily news program from Link TV, presents a selection of news reports from independent and state-controlled broadcasters from throughout the Middle East.
Rashid Al-Azawi, parliament member representing the Iraqi Accord Front, announced his retirement from the committee formed by the parliament to supervise the work of the Accountability and Justice Commission.
Meanwhile, Faraj Al-Haidari, head of the Independent High Electoral Commission, said that those covered by the resolutions of the Accountability and Justice Commission have the legal right to support his leave.
The progress of the political situation in Iraq is increasingly problematic about 2 months before the parliamentary election is set to take place. The elections will determine the ruling party for the next 4 years. The crisis began with the news of Saleh al-Mutlaq and his political party getting barred from the candidate list for the elections. This led to a series of repercussions. 500 candidates and 14 political groups have been excluded from the elections, according to the statements by Faraj al-Haidari, the head of the High Electoral Commission. Among the excluded candidates are some important figures in the government and the parliament.
وازداد الموقف تأزما بعد مداهمة قوات من عمليات بغداد مكتب صالح المطلق في فندق.
The situation deteriorated after the forces behind Operation Baghdad attacked Saleh al-Mutlaq in Rashid Hotel during his meeting with the Iraqi National Movement headed by Iyad Alawi. Iyad Alawi considered the work of the Accountability and Justice Commission to be frightening, and the uprooting of the Ba'ath Party an act used for electoral purposes. The parliament urgently formed a tripartite committee to undertake the mission of recalling the excluded candidates' profiles. But soon Rashid Al-Azawi, member of the Iraqi Accordance Front, retired from the committee to protest the mechanism of the committee and the fact that it was only given 3 days to accomplish its mission. Meanwhile, the parliament voted to form an anti-discrimination body with 7 judges. It will decide on the appeals filed by those covered by the Accountability and Justice Commission's resolutions. These legal measures have not ended the controversy about the legitimacy of the Accountability and Justice Commission and the political motivations behind its resolutions. Some Iraqi parliament members believe that the commission is the equivalent of the Expediency Discernment Council of the system in Iran. They hold the commission responsible for preserving the status quo of the politically dominant parties under the pretext of uprooting the Ba'ath Party and its supporters in order to prevent any change that may be caused by the upcoming elections. Others believe that the commission is illegal, especially after the parliament refused to include the members recommended by Prime Minister Nouri al-Maliki in the election. Some consider the independence and neutrality of the commission questionable. At the same time, some parliament members warn that the continuation of disputes between the political parties will delay voting, because the constituents are frustrated with the performance of these political elites.
An Iraqi court sentenced 11 people to death. They are accused of being behind the attacks that shocked Baghdad on August 19th of last year and led to the death of more than 100 Iraqis. The incident is known as Bloody Wednesday. Let's watch the report and examine the background of the verdicts as well as the controversy surrounding them.
The deadline is quickly approaching for U.S. troops to withdraw from the country of the two rivers. When the U.S. Army announced its intention to bring down the Iraqi regime, it used human rights as one of its major slogans. So how is Baghdad doing today?
الهاجس الأمني لا يزال الشغل الشاغل للعراقيين.
The security situation is still a major concern for Iraqis. The blast that took place on Bloody Wednesday, August 19th of 2009, led to the death of over 100 Iraqis. This did not only shock the foreign ministry and the Ministry of Finance, who were the targets of the attacks, but also confused Maliki's government, who bragged about its security achievements. Maliki's government quickly announced the arrest of defendants who admitted to receiving orders from Iraqis affiliated with Al-Qaeda and the Ba'ath Party in Syria. But the attacks did not stop there. After Bloody Wednesday, more explosions targeting the buildings of the government and ministries took place. Meanwhile, the various political groups are in dispute over the allocation of seats in parliament, which are up for election in early March. In this atmosphere, 11 people accused of planning, financing, and executing the August 19th bloody attacks have been sentenced to death by hanging. This verdict might be in response to the Iraqi public's demand for retribution against those behind the attacks, but it also raises a question about the credibility of the Iraqi judiciary system, which basically yields to the executive authorities. The Iraqi Minister of Interior, Jawad al-Bulani, announced about a month ago that the death penalty violates human rights. In fact, the verdict was reached quickly, without due process, and despite the fact that a number of relevant groups could not be reached, especially those in Syria. Damascus denies any connection to the attacks. No matter where the truth lies, questioning the credibility of Iraq's judicial system alone raises questions for Iraq after 7 years of war. Firas Kidani, BBC.
كشف خبير في مجال المواد الخطرة أن كمية اليورانيوم المنضب التي استهدفت.
According to experts, 2,000 tons of depleted uranium were used in the bombardment of Iraq in the 1991 and 2003 wars, most of which were concentrated in southern areas, especially in al-Basra and Misan. This has increased pollution in the country, which explains the spread of disease along the border areas of al-Amara, al-Basra, and Simawa.
تداعيات مختلفة التأثير كشف عنها خبير في مجال المواد الخطرة بشأن كمية اليورانيوم.
According to experts, 2,000 tons of depleted uranium were used in southern areas, especially in the provinces of al-Basra and Misan.
بنحو 2,000 طن تركز معظمها في المناطق الجنوبية وخصوصا في.
An expert in the Ministry of Science and Technology, Munjed Abdelbaki, said that the pollution in Iraq goes back to the first Gulf War in the 1980s due to the nature of weapons used by both Iran and Iraq. He said that the weapons were pollutants before and after they exploded. Contamination in the country significantly increased after the 1991 and 2003 invasions.
هذا وازداد التلوث في البلاد بصورة غير طبيعية بعد حربي الخليج الثانية في عام 1991.
The toxic wastes of British and American nuclear reactors were dumped in Iraq. Huge quantities of depleted uranium were used in the ammunition against Iraq. It was the first time in history these kinds of weapons were used.
لم تستعمل سابقا في أي حرب في العالم. ويقدر الخبراء إن ما تم إلقاؤه من اليورانيوم.
According to experts, 300 tons of depleted uranium were used in the 1991 war, and another 1,700 tons were used in the 2003 war.
1,700 طن في عام 2003.
According to scientific researchers, the radioactive contamination will affect future Iraqi generations because it affects human genes. Diseases have already spread in the border areas of Al-Amara, Al-Basra, and Al-Simawa. There is a need to stop the radioactive contamination in Iraq, but no institution has taken charge of containing it yet, because it is an extremely expensive process and requires modern equipment. There are more than 100 depleted uranium-contaminated areas in southern Iraq.
أكدت وزيرة حقوق الإنسان وجدان ميخائيل أن العراق قدم طلبا رسميا إلى الادعاء العام الأمريكي.
Iraqi Human Rights Minister Wajdan Mikhail said that Iraq submitted an official appeal to the U.S. District Attorney over an American court decision to drop the charges against Blackwater employees. Mikhail said that the American company Blackwater did not reach a settlement with the families of the people who were killed at Al-Nusur Square. She said that two of the families sued the company in two separate U.S. states.
الأمريكية. وفي السياق نفسه أكد المحامي حسن جابر سلمان الذي جرح في حادثة.
Meanwhile, lawyer Hassan Jaber Salman, who was injured in the Blackwater attack, said that all the families of the people who were killed and injured gave up their civil rights in exchange for financial compensation 2 months before the American court decided to drop the charges against the company.
$100,000 لكل قتيل فيما تراوح بين 20,000 إلى 50,000 دولار لكل جريح. لافتاً إلى أن
According to Salman, the families of the victims received $100,000 for every person who was killed and $22,000 to $25,000 for every injured person. All the families of the martyrs agreed to this compensation except for one person who lost both his son and daughter. He said that Blackwater offered him financial compensation on 4 occasions. He continued to reject these offers until he heard that Blackwater might file for bankruptcy, which compelled him to accept their offer.
The revocation of Jerusalem residency permits of 50,000 Palestinians has become the focus of many human rights organizations. Our reporter Iman Erekat has the details.
Beit Hanina in Jerusalem is the hometown of Hana Abu Said, who lives with his wife. The Israeli Ministry of Interior notified him that he has to give up his Jerusalem residency card, which means that he will no longer be allowed to live in Jerusalem.
Now I have the Jerusalem residency card, which will expire in 2012. But I'm afraid of losing it if I go to the U.S. I'm also afraid of staying here. I just do not know what to do, because after 2012, I can no longer make the Israeli government renew my Jerusalem residency card. I have been consulting lawyers to see whether or not I can travel.
أما عائلة المقدسية نبال صافي والمتزوجة من فلسطيني يحمل هوية الضفة الغربية.
Nibal Safi, who has a Jerusalem residency card, married a Palestinian man from the West Bank. In order to keep her family together, she was forced to move 3 years ago from Shuafat inside Jerusalem to the town of Kfur Aqab, which is within the Jerusalem perimeter. However, when Israel built the wall, the town of Kfur Aqab was isolated from the rest of Jerusalem. Nibal paid all her due taxes to the Israeli government, including the real estate tax, but is now threatened with losing her Jerusalem residency rights. According to Israeli law, anybody who lives more than 7 years outside of Jerusalem can lose their Jerusalem residency rights.
I'm facing two options. I either give up my Jerusalem residency rights and go live with my husband in the West Bank, or leave my husband and live with my children who have Jerusalem residency rights. But this means that I have to live separated from my husband. My family will be divided, and I will no longer be able to live with my husband.
Palestinian concerns increased when an Israeli official in East Jerusalem said that Palestinians who live on the other side of the separation wall can no longer maintain their Jerusalem residency rights. This means that Israel can revoke the Jerusalem residency rights of more than 50,000 Palestinians. The municipality of Jerusalem refused to comment on these statements.
These issues are political. If the Arab villages surrounding Jerusalem are given up and handed over to the future Palestinian state, of course the future borders of Jerusalem will be different than those of today's.
وبحسب تقديرات مركز القدس فقد شهد عام 2008 على فقدان نحو 5,000 مقدسية.
According to the Jerusalem Center, 14,000 Palestinians lost their Jerusalem residency rights in 2008. It is worth mentioning that we have not had precise information about these numbers for the past 3 years. From the Israeli perspective, the Palestinian villages separated from Jerusalem by the wall are no longer within the jurisdiction of Jerusalem's municipality, and therefore the residents there can't acquire all the civic services. At the same time, the Palestinian Authority is also not allowed to provide services to these Palestinians. From Kufar Aqab, northern Jerusalem, Manal Araikat, BBC.
The Israeli enemy released five of its soldiers arrested a month ago for abusing Sha'lan Abu Najma, a Palestinian youth from the city of Hebron. The Israeli soldiers brutally beat Abu Najma while handcuffed in custody with their hands, feet, and batons. After he was beaten, Abu Najma was taken into a bathroom where the soldiers threw feces on him and took pictures. The incident took place at the headquarters of a Zionist security institution. The Zionist authorities seized the photos from the soldiers' mobile phones but never published them. During the war on Gaza, the Israeli enemy used the worst types of weapons known to mankind, namely white phosphorus. The effects of white phosphorus are still showing up on the bodies of Palestinians in the Gaza Strip. They are also casting their negative shadow on Gaza's agriculture and soil.
A scorching fiery ball, followed by another and another, fell on the Gaza Strip during the war. Dozens of internationally banned white phosphoric shells fell on Gaza, casting negative effects even a year later. There are many victims, men, women, and children, including aborted fetuses and newborn babies.
There is evidence of deformity among the newborn and premature babies. This evidence of deformity can be seen in nurseries across Gaza's hospitals. Since the war and up until today, the number of deformity cases has exceeded 75.
In numbers, several human rights organizations, including the Damir for Human Rights Association, confirm that the number of birth defects in Gaza has increased by 40% following the Israeli aggression. Nearly 50% of the cases have shown signs of defects of the nervous system or limbs. Most of the birth defects were reported in the areas of Jabalia, Beit Hanun, and Beit Lahia, which suffered the most from the use of these illegal weapons. These illegal weapons didn't only affect humans, but also altered the agriculture and ecosystem in the Gaza Strip. According to a study conducted by an Italian special agricultural team, the level of Gaza's soil contamination increased from 25% to 3,000%.
We've recently noticed that vegetation stopped growing in certain areas. Some plants have mutated, and others have turned yellow, showing strange features unfamiliar to agricultural engineers. There is strong evidence indicating that some plants have been exposed to radioactive materials or heavy elements.
It seems that the drama of this war has not ended, with some episodes continuing to play out on Gaza's soil, in its air, and for its future generations. Bassam Al-Batta, Al-Aqsa Satellite Channel, Gaza.
This Mauritanian market was named after the Afghan city of Kandahar. It is a huge public market located in the suburbs of the capital, Nouakchott. Mauritanians go there often because it has many products imported from all over the globe. Mahmoudi Mohammed reports from Nouakchott.
There is a notable decrease in the number of shoppers in Mauritania's modern markets. Although the products sold at these markets are imported from all over the world, they are not very popular. The expensive prices of these products might be one of the reasons. However, the main reason is that these products do not meet the specific demand of consumers. Here, people prefer to go to the public markets that are widespread in the cities.
We have many modern markets throughout the capital, but Mauritanians often prefer public markets, which tend to be crowded.
Kandahar is the most famous of these markets. In this market, one can find everything, including goats and cellular phones. The people sitting here are currency exchangers. Inside, the big stores are located, such as those who fix cellular phones and computers, and those selling fast food. Here, one can find items that can be categorized as illegal. It is possible for some vendors to enter Kandahar market with no money in their pockets and leave with lots of money, as long as they are known for their honesty and credibility.
The market is very good. Some people have a capital exceeding 10 million okiya, and the customers are very happy. May God bless the market.
When Ahmed entered the market, he did not even have one qiyya, but in 2 years, he has managed to become the owner of this shop that fixes cellular phones.
Some sellers move around, as you can see in the square. I prefer to work here. The market is open for everyone. Any young man can come and work here. Thank God, business is good.
Vendors need to be ambitious to become successful, whether they are selling their products inside the Kandahar market or outside it. But those with bigger ambitions tend to have more accomplishments. The biggest accomplishment here is to open a big store inside the market, not outside it.
A bomb explodes near an Israeli diplomatic convoy in Jordan. Al-Qaeda assassinates a Jordanian intelligence officer. Jordanian Islamists are fighting in Afghanistan. Are Jordanian intelligence agencies good enough to fight Al-Qaeda? And why do Jordanian opposition groups want the government to drop its pro-America stance? Answers to these questions and more on Link TV's Mosaic Intelligence Report.
The recent incident of the Jordanian suicide bomber who blew himself up at a central intelligence agency base in Khos province, Afghanistan, took many Jordanians by surprise, especially when they learned through the media about the depth of the cooperation between their government's intelligence service called the Mukhabarat and the United States in its war on terror. The Jordanian intelligence services recruited Humam Khalil Abu Malal al-Bilawi and put him in touch with the CIA, and Jordan has since been deeply embarrassed by the fact that Bilawi turned out to be a double agent. Jordanians have also recently been made aware of the fact that an increasing number of their nationals have been volunteering to join the Taliban and Al-Qaeda to fight against the United States in Pakistan and Afghanistan. Only days after the funeral of Captain Sharif Ali bin Zayed, the Jordanian Mukhabarat agent killed in the Khos attack, which was televised on Jordanian television and attended by King Abdullah II and other high-ranking officials, a memorial took place for a Jordanian Al-Qaeda member who was recently killed in a U.S. drone attack along the Afghanistan-Pakistan border. Bearded men poured into a reception hall in the town of Irbid to offer their condolences to his family.
I'm proud of my son because he's a martyr who died in jihad against the Americans and the oppressive enemies of the Arab and Muslim world.
He spent the first 8 months in Afghanistan in military training. He was obedient and was known to be a good listener. He met many Taliban leaders, including Mullah Omar. He was very comfortable dealing with the Taliban. Many Taliban members studied the Quran with him.
Most of these Al-Qaeda members are known to be from the sprawling towns of Irbid and Zarqa, which was the hometown of the late Al-Qaeda leader in Iraq, Abu Mus'ab al-Zarqawi. This week, the Muslim Brotherhood and other opposition groups demanded that the Jordanian government drop its pro-American stance. In a statement titled, "It's Not Our War," they wrote, "We demand an end to the policy of what is called cooperation or security coordination with the Zionist enemy or the American intelligence agencies and the withdrawal of Jordanian forces from Afghanistan." According to the Associated Press, Zaki Saad, former director of the Islamic Action Front, The Muslim Brotherhood's political wing in Jordan said that there was so much anger against the government's policies and the marginalization of mainstream Islamist groups like his own that it was driving radical young people into the arms of Al-Qaeda.
The Jordanian constitution stipulates clearly defining the missions and assignments of the Jordanian armed military forces. Therefore, sending Jordanian forces abroad outside the framework of defending Jordanian national security on Jordanian soil is considered a violation of the constitution. We can call this incident a double embarrassment. If it happened in any other respectable and democratic country, governments there would fall and collapse.
Jordan itself has experienced several terror attacks on its territories. In 2005, three suicide attackers detonated nearly simultaneous explosions at hotels in downtown Amman, killing 67 people and wounding more than 150 others. Many experts argue that it was after those attacks that the Jordanian Mukhabarat decided to work closely with the CIA in combating Al-Qaeda. On Thursday, a roadside bomb exploded near a convoy of vehicles carrying Israeli diplomats in Jordan near the Jordanian village of Na'ur as the convoy was traveling from Amman, the Jordanian capital, to the Allenby Bridge border crossing. Although there have been numerous threats against Israeli diplomats and visitors to Jordan since the two countries signed a peace treaty in 1994, this incident cannot be treated as an isolated one. Security officials have speculated that this recent attack on the Israeli diplomats might have been the work of a group affiliated with Al-Qaeda or a Palestinian group. In either case, this is the second time in less than a month that the Jordanian Mukhabarat suffers from a breach in security, one too many for a small country like Jordan. I'm Jamal Dajani for the Mosaic Intelligence Report. To learn more about this program or to share your thoughts, visit us at linktv.org/mir. You can also follow my updates on Twitter.
Get more news about the Middle East online at linktv.org/mosaic. The Mosaic webpage offers a complete archive of Mosaic programs, program transcripts, the Mosaic Video Podcast, and the Mosaic Intelligence Report, a weekly analysis of the hottest stories from the Middle East. The views expressed on Mosaic are those of the participating broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible with the support of viewers like you. Thank you.
This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. network dedicated to global and national news, uncompromising documentaries, and diverse cultural programs, programs which connect you to the world.